All right, I'd like to thank everyone for coming out tonight. We have a good showing here, both from law enforcement and from the community. My name's Tom Flanagan. I'm an assistant DA here in Plymouth County. We have a Operation Safe Streets Task Force meeting here now tonight. This is the fourth meeting that will be held here in the city of Brockton under Operation Safe Streets. I'd like to thank all the law enforcement and community members for attending, and also those of you watching this at home on Brockton Cable Access. The Brockton community benefits from close cooperation between state, local, and federal law enforcement agencies. And the spirit behind this Operation Safe Streets effort is that cooperation is the key to a safe community. Cooperation between law enforcement agencies, as well as cooperation between the community members and law enforcement. We can't succeed in our public safety mission without people in the community having the courage to stand up and fight for justice and safety with us. So this Operation Safe Streets approach is about coming together for a safer community and to improve the quality of life here in Brockton. I'd like to take note of some individuals that are here, and then I'm going to ask the leaders of the law enforcement agencies taking part and available here tonight to answer your questions and to say a few words about their ongoing current efforts in the city of Brockton. I'd like to thank Maria DelCanto, Director of Diversity and Community Relations for the Plymouth County District Attorney's Office. I'd also like to introduce a new prosecutor in Plymouth County who's going to be working on community prosecutions. To my right is Assistant DA Joe Janazek. He's a new Plymouth County Assistant DA. He's recently joined our office from the Suffolk County District Attorney's Office, where he served as the chief of the gang unit in the city of Boston. He is the coordinator of gang and community prosecutions unit within our office now. And I also point out we have a couple of Superior Court ADAs that are also working in that unit for the Plymouth County DA's office. Nate Kennedy and Jason Thomas also present here tonight. This is one of the lead initiatives within the District Attorney's Office in our efforts in working with the state police, federal agencies, and the Brockton police to try to improve the quality of life here in the city of Brockton. The whole point of this new unit that's been recently organized within the District Attorney's Office is to identify what we refer to as impact players in the community. Those individuals who are out there leading the way in causing the trouble on the street, leading the way in firearms and gang violence and problems on the street, identifying them and then effectively prosecuting them. Members of that unit are also assisting law enforcement in reviewing search warrant affidavits and police reports, coordinating grand jury investigations, and prosecuting cases in Superior Court. So without further ado, I'd like to give Joe Janazek an opportunity to introduce himself to the community of Brockton. Joe?
Thank you very much, Tom. Good evening, everybody. It's great to see so many faces in the room tonight, and I'm humbled to be here. You know, the fact that this meeting is happening means this community has a leg up. Frankly, we're ahead of the game, and I came from a very strong tradition of that in Boston. If everybody, you know, remembers what the Boston Miracle was all about, it went from 150 plus homicides 1 year to I think under 20 homicides a couple of years later. That's extraordinary. The key to that, it's nothing magical. It's what we're doing here tonight. It's exactly what you're looking at. Not just a coordinated effort by law enforcement, but it's folks from the neighborhoods coming out. It's us interacting, it's dialogue, it is relationships. And those are not built by just a meeting or two. It's us being out, accessible. It's us, you know, talking to folks all the time about what's going on. And it's not just the violent activities, but it's the precursor activities to violence. It's the kids sitting on the stoop of the house that they don't belong at. And folks making a phone call, feeling empowered enough to say, hey, I'd like the police to come along and move these kids along, because those kids might have drama with some other kids, and the next thing you know, somebody's shooting up somebody's house over some nonsense. And you all have heard it before. I'm not telling you anything new, but I'm really looking forward to the fact that there's already this group in place, there's already dialogue, there's nothing that I like more than to come back to a meeting after somebody has said, hey, the house on my block, there's a lot of activity. It's drug activity. We know it is. There's people in and out of there all the time. We'd like you to do something about it. And then we, as law enforcement partners, go out, whether it's Lieutenant from Brockton or state or our federal partners, whoever it is. And we come back in a month or two and we say, by the way, the Brockton Police Drug Control Unit, the Mass State Police Gang Unit, the Brockton Police Gang Unit just hit that house. We had three arrests that came out of there. They were all impact guys. They were all guys that were involved in shootings, prior drug activity. How has the activity been on your street since then? And people are like, it's great. Haven't heard a peep. Everything's quieted down. It went from 100 to zero in the course of a day. There's nothing I like better than that. So I'm looking forward to having that conversation very shortly with you. Thank you all for having me. It's a pleasure to be here, and thank you.
Thanks, Joe. We're going to pass it along the table here so the gentlemen to either side of me can introduce themselves, and then I'm going to open up to the floor.
My name is Ken LeGrice. I'm head of the Detective Bureau in the Brockton Police Department.
Good evening. My name is Kevin White. I'm the Supervisory Special Agent with the FBI out of Lakeville, and we work here in Brockton with the State Police and Brockton PD.
My name is Major Tony Thomas. I'm the Troop D Commander. We have a long-time partnership with Brockton PD and the FBI, and a very strong collaborative to make safe neighborhoods here and to preserve this neighborhood and stamp down violent crimes and gang-related crimes and firearms and drugs. And we're all in this together, and we're glad to partner up with the team up here tonight.
Thank you, Major. Good evening, everybody. I'm Phil Griffin. I'm a sergeant with the Plymouth County Sheriff's Department. Sheriff McDonald would love to have been here tonight, be another engagement he had to go to. Again, we're with the Plymouth County Sheriff's Department. Our role is basically a support of the Brockton Police, the State Police, and any federal agencies that need our help in the crime scene production or support in moving prisoners and the care and custody of them. Thank you.
Thank you. The DA sends his regrets. He's preparing to go out of state at a National District Attorney's Conference. And I understand as well that Mayor Carpenter is ill with the flu that's going around at this time, but they were not able to be here this evening. At this time, we're going to open it up to the floor. And I know we have Maria has the microphone. And this is an opportunity for those of you in the audience to pose any questions or offer any information that you think would be productive for law enforcement to hear and potentially act on. Thank you.
A question. My name is Gene Bradley, the Wayne Court, and I work for Senator Michael Whitty. So I just want to let everybody know that the senator would love to be here, but unfortunately, he has something to do because someone in his family passed, so he has to attend the funeral. So that's it.
Questions, comments, don't be shy.
This might be the only chance I get to talk without being interrogated. But good evening. My name is Steve Abrams. I just want to thank the panel for showing up. Just a moment of silence for those law enforcement who have lost their lives this month of March. If we may have a moment of silence for that, because it is one of the hardest jobs that we have. Thank you. With that being said, I would just like to say United States Army, 23 years,
2 years in the sandbox as an MP wasn't the greatest job, but it was the one thing that we did do in Kosovo and in the Balkans. We went down every street, we knew every house, we talked to all the local nationals. How can that model continue in the city of Brockton? Because I did not look like any of the people that I talked to. So what that had to do is some of my interpreters, some of the local nationals, they lived with us. They talked to us, they had the best intel. So when they seen us, they didn't fear us. They spoke with us, and you know, a lot of guys was in a safe environment at that time. How can we use some of the models that has been proven to work? People have the same hue, walking these streets, talking these streets, collaborating with law enforcement, not to be such a threat. We have a lot of bad actors. If I know them, you know, snitching is no longer a bad thing. It saves lives. And so what are some of the things that, I know you're from Boston, that you have done to interact with the neighborhood, speak the same language, talk the same talk, walk the same walk, and not be such a off-standing posture towards the community? That helps. And if there's some way to school the pipeline to prison, we have to work with that, because law enforcement, everybody wants to do that job. It's a great job. However, there's a threat there. I don't know where the disconnect is at, but it's something that we can work with, and just want to get some of your ideas on that. Thank you.
That's the key, right? That's the key. How do we establish that relationship? Because it really is. That's what exactly what you're talking about. At the end of the day, is a relationship. And I think you know, one of the keys that you know is so important to that relationship building is that constant. First of all, constant presence, right? You need to know your neighbors. We're your neighbors, and, you know. And so the barrier between law enforcement and the community, that's affection. When you're doing it right, everybody's together. There's a collaboration. Everybody sitting around you is part of the community. And so to get us out of the fictionalized mindset of us and them and the barriers, you know, presence, get to know me. I don't know you yet. I'm very hopeful that I get to know you soon. In fact, I would love to talk to you afterward. That's the start. It's not the end, but it's the start. You have the bad actors. Those are guys that everybody kind of knows what to do with, right? We are, as law enforcement, you know, prosecution, and just speaking from our discipline, is a very reactive profession, okay? So if somebody gets arrested, we prosecute that person, and we recommend what happens to them. I would prefer not to see somebody in front of me in the courtroom. I would much rather grab a cup of coffee with that kid at Dunkin' Donuts and talk to them, and maybe, you know, maybe give him a little advice that could potentially send him in a totally different direction than where he's going right now. This gentleman right here and I just spoke very briefly for about 5 minutes before the presentation, and we talked about how there are 16, 17, 15-year-old kids that don't see that they're going to live past 18. Okay, that's reality. They don't see past their 18th birthday. If that's the mindset that you're dealing with, that's a problem, right? Because there's no consequence for that person. That's a big problem. And what are we as a community going to do about it? It's not a law enforcement thing. It's a community thing. What can we do to prevent kids from getting in the life in the first place? Why are there kids, you know, hanging around with nothing to do? Let's say in the summertime. What are we going to do about those kids? What are we going to do about the kids that are attracted to it enough that they're on the fringes of it and they want to impress somebody that's bigger, right? Somebody who's an impact player, somebody who frankly wants to insulate themselves with that young guy coming up and telling that person, yeah, go out and do this shooting. What are we going to do about that? That's the dialogue that we all have to be having. And again, it starts with this. And it starts with after this, you know, every day, right? Every month, every year. And it's a relationship that is built over time. But look around you. Everybody's in this room because they're committed to that concept. And the quicker we can get past the barrier of us and them, the better it is.
So I think I could just shed a little light on your question. You're basically talking about policing models, correct?
Yes, sir.
Good. And domestic policing models for the past 20-odd years have been community policing in different branches of community policing, such as problem-oriented policing, intelligence-driven policing. But it all centers around community policing, relationship building. And in Brockton, we have old neighborhoods with emerging new populations. And those people, the dynamics of that emerging population, these young people trying to assimilate with a whole bunch of problems today. So we have to create safe neighborhoods, but we can't do it all by ourselves. We need the people that live in that neighborhood, right, to build the infrastructure and the values and help incorporate some systems into that neighborhood with these young people so that they won't go to violence, they won't go to gangs, they won't go to drug distribution and firearms. They're so plentiful today. They weren't like that 20 years ago. And it's about education. It's about education. It's about our schools. And I wish we had more educators here from our grade schools and our high schools, because we need to intercept these kids that we think are coming out of troubled homes when they're in grade school. And if we can identify them there and have some intervention there, maybe we can prevent them tracking down the path of gang violence and drug distribution and assimilate a little better in a new emerging community. Because these old neighborhoods, right, people that were there 15, 20 years ago, they've moved out. They've sold to new families trying to build their lives in America, right? We've got a very diverse population in Brockton, not unlike the emerging populations in New Bedford and Fall River and Lowell and pockets of Boston, right, and the other big cities. And so the challenge is, diverse. We can't lock up people and lock our way out of this problem, right, by making mass arrests. Because 20 years ago, I think Kenny LeGrace can concur, John Brooks, we made a lot of arrests in this city, and that population we put away, and there's always someone stepping up. And, you know, they're not implying, creating a new app, a new technology, right? What's their solution? Gangs and drug distribution and violence, right? That's what they're going to the fast box. So the prosecutors are working hand in hand. We have some technologies that are far advanced today helping us to track violent criminals, and we're having a lot of success, and we're taking out impact players. But we were taking out impact players 20 years ago with archaic technology. We're much more advanced now. We have eyes in the skies. We can do some great things. And Kevin White from the FBI and Kenny LeGrace are doing those great things right now as we sit here along with the state police.
Thanks, Steve. And I think another important point that you mentioned is things are starting to change. I don't think I'm being overly optimistic when I say that about people being willing to come forward if they see something. If they are a witness of something that happened in their neighborhood, in the district attorney's office, we see it on a regular basis that people in the Brockton community are stepping up. They're telling the police what they saw. And this is a point that we made in the inaugural Operation Safe Streets meeting here last September, talking about the need for members in the community, if we're going to keep the community safe and take that relatively small number of bad actors off the street that are causing a lot of the violence and the dangerous conditions out in the street. We need people that are witness to the crimes that are going on out there to have the courage to stand up. Because as hard as all the law enforcement officers out on the street on the front lines work, And as hard as those of us that wear the suits and go into court and present the evidence, as hard as we work, we can't do it without people that are going to stand up and raise their hand, take the oath, and then tell a jury or a fact finder what they saw happen out on the street. And that's a key component to the partnership that we need to keep the community safe. So I think you made some excellent points. Thank you.
Hi, Harry here from Operation Archangels, no affiliation with the Guiding Angels. My question is, I noticed you said that if there's a lot of suspicious activity, kids hanging out on the porch to call it in. Now, is there going to be enough police to do that, especially when they're busy chasing from one 911 call to the next? Because a lot of times at night we see a lot of like suspicious activity. We try to detail the crime, but however, sometimes it's not enough. We need a police cruiser to show up to say, like, hey, you know, moving along. Because I noticed too that that's how a lot of the crimes start to happen, people hanging out on the block.
Well, I know that I'll start off the answer to that, and then I'll hand it off to Kenny. But I know there's more cars out there, more officers out on the streets, and it's not going to be a situation where every single trespassing call that there's going to be a cruiser there in five, 10 minutes. But it's something we can aim for, and certainly those are quality of life issues, like the broken window doctrine. Where, you know, it seems it's a minor, might appear to be a minor issue, or trespassing being a minor offense. But for the people that live in that building, that have posted the sign and they're dealing with loud noise at all hours of the night from young people, it's not a minor thing to those people. It makes it hard to get up in the morning and go to work, support your family. So it's something I know the Brockton police are very aware of. It's one of those, in the big spectrum of things as far as the crimes in the city go, it's not a major crime, but it's important to the quality of life, and I know that they're working on it at Brockton PD. Kenny?
In those cases there, all I can suggest is that you have to make the phone call. I mean, I'm not going to tell you, we can always use more police officers, but the current administration has added 9 more that just hit the street recently, and we've increased our numbers over the last couple of years, so we're going in the right direction. But I can honestly say there are very few calls in the Brockton Police that go unanswered due to manpower situations. And they would be, things that might fall in the lower spectrum. Believe it or not, we consider those important calls, especially someone sitting on a place where they don't belong. We know what it breeds and we know what it's going to bring. So we do answer, I would say, very close to 100% of every call that comes in. The only thing that's going to be dictated by that is the amount of serious calls that we're handling at that one time. So it might be delayed if it's a lower priority call, but we're coming at some point in time. It's just whether they're still going to be there. All right? So we just need to make, as a society, we have to keep making those phone calls.
Thanks, Kenny. Tony?
Yeah, I'd just like to add that in the past 21 years, since 1995, we've had the community action team here, a subset of community policing. We've done hundreds of patrols in this city alongside Brockton PD MOC units. I mean, literally hundreds of patrols, probably thousands of patrols. We've made thousands of drug arrests, firearms arrests, violent arrests, quality of life issues. We're all over the city, and Brockton PD is extremely active with us. They hear us, we hear them. We have their scanners. So you're getting a lot of resources and uniform resources put out by Brockton PD and the state police. And again, it highlights our long-term commitment and the collaborative we have with Brockton PD.
Thanks, Tony.
How you doing? I'm Ozzie Jordan. Glad to see you folks here again. Some of you have been here a few times, some it may be your first time. A lot of things we're talking about have been happening for years, you're talking 20 years, go back 40, 50 years, and you're getting a little more realistic of how Brockton has been and what it's changed too. Okay, when we had a community, not just Boston, but Massachusetts pretty much as a whole, since you're covering the Mass State Police, it's changed, it's not the same. A lot of us in here, if you're over 40 or better, you grew up in a community. You walked down the street, everybody knew you. Everybody knew you, okay? At this time of night, you wouldn't be on the street because somebody would have snatched you and you would have been home. Can't do that today because then you're out looking for that person, unfortunately. But that's another ball game, okay? But that's the way we grew up. You mentioned putting up a no trespass sign. How many people know how to do that? What do they know? What's that about? What kind of education have we provided to the community to say, put up your no trespassing sign so when an officer comes, you're violating, okay? It's posted. A lot of people don't know that, okay? So it's education. Somebody mentioned that. Not down to the primary grades. We need to start at home. As soon as that kid can start walking, that's when we need to start this. Now, I'm not saying it's the school's job to do that. That's the family. Those are things that aren't happening either, like they used to. Okay, a lot of people have to go out and work 2, 3, 4 jobs. That's another whole situation, okay? But it's all putting all of that together. One of the things I've seen has been this, what I call a run-through, okay? So you run through the community, you do what you gotta do, and then people forget because they got other things they need to do. That has to be continuous, like planning. Assessment, plan, execute. Same thing, continuously, all right? In between a call, got to be doing that community stuff. Can't sit and relax, all right? Being paid for the 8 hours or whatever it is, never mind Dunkin' Donuts and all that, and I'm just kidding about that because I know the guys are working. I know they are. But still, you can't take that break. That's the time to be out there and dealing with the community, the local people. Find out if those kids on the stairs belong there or not. All right. It may be somebody sitting next door from the next door house as opposed to somebody who doesn't belong in the street. That's community. That's the old community when you walk the beats, which is unreasonable today. But these are the things that are missing and we need to have. We need that education. Yes, we need the folks on the street, but we need the education across the board. Oh, by the way, thank you for having a meeting at 7 o'clock and not at 4 or 3, as some people do, or what have you, so you can allow people to come out. I'm a little upset that there aren't community people here, okay? It's about a half a dozen community people here. There's more law enforcement in this room than we have community people. I only see one of our elected representatives here at the moment. I'm talking actual representative, no matter the representatives who are sitting in for, but I understand in the case of Mike's case, okay? But last couple of times, everybody was here, all right? All the top folks were here. People look at that, okay? And it's I know people are busy, I know people have commitments, etc., all right? But those are the things that people look at. They look to see what's going on. All the different programs have been tried. They were working very well in this city. That's why we've improved. But you can't stop it once you go through it one time around. You got to take a look at it. Where did it fail? Where can we make the improvements? You know, just ping it a little bit. Got somebody coming out of Boston. What they do is get all the stuff going around the country to figure out what's the best things to use. We can take advantage of that. That's information we don't get locally here normally, unless you pay attention or go to certain things to find out what's what. As I always say, somewhere in this country, whatever the problem is, it's been resolved. I don't care what it is, it's been resolved. So all you need to do is to find that, bring it here, and make it fit for Brockton. But not bad mouth in any of you. It's just a case of we need to keep doing the same thing over and over. It's boring. It's a pain. But it's the only way it works. Because as you were saying, as the state police officer was saying, you've got new people coming through. A lot of them don't know what's what. They don't know where to go. The people who are coming in from outside, as you know, a lot of their cultures, they don't go near government. I mean, you know the background on all that. You go, you don't get seen again or what have you. So, I mean, these are things that you have to know. You got to know who your people are. If you're doing real good community stuff, you know who the good people in the community and the so-called perps, okay? So you don't make those mistakes because that happens at times too, especially when you have multiple forces coming in and they have no idea who the people are. So please do what you're doing, but keep doing it. Don't do a one run and stop. And as we know, we keep getting new kids replacing those that have been arrested. We have new police officers. So as they come in, the new ones have to go through it too. So thank you.
Ozzy, I just want to thank you for your comments. As a community person, how do you advise us as the DA's office to reach out to other folks? Because only if you knew how I managed to do that for today and other times, how can you tell us to get parents and educators and teachers? What ideas do you have that we can outreach to them? You're going to make it short.
Yeah, I know.
All right. Stay right here.
Yeah, I don't make it short. People know that. So. We used to do some things years ago. We worked with the utilities where you in the bills went out certain things. I happened to get this particular information because I'm on a list. I got an email. I didn't see it in the newspaper. I don't hear anybody I know talking about it. There was a time that people would be saying, there's a meeting going on tonight. Are you going? That kind of thing. We need to not always rely on just the technology of today because not everybody has it. Okay, or even if they do have computers, they don't have the money to be online. So, I mean, these are things that we sometimes go too far in one direction. And it is great. And I know you guys that can tell, yeah, it's great. But you still need that person with the eyes and the ears, as you say. Because the technology can only go so far. But people don't use it. So it's getting out to, in the community, to the places that people are. Getting to the churches, still a good place to go. Getting to those older folks that still can control a lot of those younger folks, the grandmothers, the aunts, the uncles, the great aunts, great uncles, still have that ability. They're not afraid to do that, okay? So those are the people you need to get to who can get to some of these younger folks.
Thank you so much.
Good evening. My name is Ajis Pierre, and thank you for your service in Broughton, because we need that. Like Ozzy just said, I remember last meeting that I went, it was at the DA's office. And I stood up, I said the same thing. The way you guys make the announcement for those meetings is not appropriate. We need to reach out to the pastors, the churches, that's where we have people. The school. Send someone to the school, send something with their kids to their parents. Then they will come. Because last time I was there, it was most likely police officers. And today is the same thing again. That means something is not working. And I hope the next time we're going to have that meeting, we reach out to those people in the churches because the meeting is for them. Not for you folks, but for the community. And I have a question. My question is, what is your best answer to someone who came to me, is a 22 years old boy. He told me that he went to jail because he was doing drugs. When he got out, because of his curry, he cannot find any job to do. Therefore, he has to go back in the street again to sell drugs because they don't have curry when you're selling drugs. Tonight, I would like to know what the best answer can you give a young kid like that. Thank you.
An answer that I would give that young person in that situation is, first of all, there's been reforms in the Corey law that protect that information quite a bit than it had been protected in the past. I can also tell you in response to that situation that you mentioned where he got involved in drugs. He's now out there trying to do the right thing. Simply, you've got to keep working, keep looking, and you'll get that break. The Corey laws, there's protections that are built in for people so they can get a chance to have a fresh start. And that's important. But it's also balanced against the business owners and the individuals who may, depending on the line of work, may have a need to know that kind of a background. In a lot of jobs, it would be fine. It would be appropriate for someone to get a second chance and work in it. Some jobs are more sensitive. So I don't think that any one of us could give a catch-all answer to that young man, except the fact that he's out looking for a job and not still doing drugs shows a great deal of hope for the young man. I know that both Joe and I, as well as our colleagues here at this table, Jason and Nate, have been involved in what's referred to as a reentry program. It's for young offenders that have not much of a prior record, and they're getting ready to be released back out into the community after their first time in jail, quite typically. And the message that we deliver to them at the end of what this reentry program, in which they're hearing about all kinds of service providers that can help them go back out into the community and hopefully never go back to jail again. We go at the end and we explain to them that, you know, if you don't take advantage of the programs that these good people are telling you about here today, there's a good chance you'll end up coming back under a new offense. And with prior convictions, you're looking at a longer period of incarceration next time. And I feel that I would say to that young man that you've just mentioned who's out there working hard to get a job, the same way that I feel towards those young men I've been in front of at the reentry programs. And that is basically the message I deliver to these groups of young men, usually about 15 at a time or so, is that we may have been on the other side of the line from each other in the past, maybe in a courtroom, but today we're on the same page, because you don't want to ever have to come back here where you get told where to go and you're in a cell for most of the day and people are telling you what you can wear and what you have to eat and what you can do every hour of the day. You want to go out and live a full and complete and a happy life, and that's what I want for you. So he's just going to keep trying, keep pushing, and with that attitude that he sounds like he's exhibiting, he's going to be successful. That's what I would say to him.
What I mean by this is that, like he just said, I mean, take a look in the room, you don't really see too many, you know, people that belong to this community. Of course, we got more law enforcement than people that live in this city. I mean, I think some people would like to come. But I feel like the fact that maybe the information wasn't, I don't know, well, you know, displayed and not too many people know about it, so they just, you know, don't want to get engaged on it. But me, as a young person, I feel like one of the best ways for us to actually improve our community is by improving that way of communication. And as you know, well, as of right now, we are focused on Brockton, but the problem is not just in Brockton, because we got people who come, you know, all over, you know, the state to actually do crazy stuff in the city. So if our focus is only on this city, it's gonna be an issue, because, you know, I went to Massasoit Community College and I went to school with a bunch of kids. I'm not going to tell you all of them are bad or all of them are good, but I've heard when they talk and stuff like that. So some of them don't even live in this city, but they come to this city to do certain things. So it's going to take a lot of courage for me as a young person who kind of like know what's going on and exposed to it. I mean, even if I'm not doing it, to actually approach you and giving you that information and not having you, I don't know, using that information, not just against that person, but against me. So how do we build that communication system so you can actually approach me in a way that I will listen to you? At your first comment, you said, how can you, you know, have, I don't know, coffee with that young person or tea with that young person to give them a sense of belonging. You see what I mean? Because some of these kids who are doing this, they probably feel like, well, I am on my own and nobody cares and I don't have anybody to talk to. But I feel like the moment we develop that ability to actually give them, not just one, but all of them, the opportunity to actually know that, well, Mr. Y and Mr. X and Mr. Z is there for you, you can actually talk with them. They will be able to not just stop doing the bad thing, but, you know, develop that friendship, which you truly need, because these are our young people that will expose to any kind of stuff. So then you will be able to target anybody. But I think until we find a way to build that communication system, you cannot do it. For me, I think communication is key, because it's sort of like the basic foundation of what we are trying to build, because a strong community lead to a safety community, because even if you are out there with, I don't know, that gun, you know, to making sure that everybody is safe, let's face it, if I'm not safe, you are not safe, but if I'm safe, you are safe. And how do we build that, you know, that family, that community? Like you said, in Brockton, we have, you know, all kind of people. We have people that know how to speak the language. We have people that don't know how to speak the language. How do we approach the folks that speak the language to actually, some of these folks speak more than one, to actually approach the people that don't speak it in a way that they can get the information and give it to us? You see what I mean? I think we need to build that foundation. Once we build a foundation, like, you know, a mom from Haiti, a mom from Kivert, a mom from anywhere can actually talk to someone that he or she knows how to speak the language, and then he or she take that information and give it to you. Because some of these folk see the bad thing, but they don't really know how to give it out. Do you see what I mean? They can't, because they don't speak that language. But if they know that there is a place for them to go, there's somebody to talk to, there's someone who is there, we might be able to, you know, not solve it. Because solving a problem is not easy, but minimize the problem. By minimizing the problem, we can lead to improving the situation. By improving the situation, hopefully we can solve it. But if we're going to try to just solve everything at once, it's not going to lead to anything. But if we build that foundation and having these people believe in us, trust us, and willing to come and give us the information, there might be a possibility for someone like me to come in front of you and tell you what's going on. You see what I mean? Because we as young people, as you know it, everybody was 19, everybody was 21, everybody was 50. We do have desire, we do have needs, but guess what? Just because we have need doesn't mean we're going to talk to somebody that can listen to us. Me, as a young person, I feel like it is important to all of us, not just one of us, but to making sure that we are here to help everybody, because, you know, the outcome of that will be good for all of us, and the consequences sometimes can be hard, even if it's not your child, even if it's not your neighbor. But when you see, you know, a 15 years old, a 17 years old, or I don't know, 21 years old in jail, it hurts you. And how do you prevent that? You see what I mean? You know, education is great, but there are many kind of education, because the education that you receive in school, it's not the same as the education that I talk to Kevin and share ideas and take his advice and improve it. You see what I mean? We have to build that. And I think, you know, that's all I can say.
Thank you, Eugene. Some great points. And speaking of that, let me get to you, Ms. Barnes, 1 minute. I do want to just commend. I did myself try to reach different ways. I'm always open, and I, you know, please approach me. I can be reached at the DA's office, and I'm always open to new ways to reach out. And I won't sit here and list the places, but I do want to commend the two young men who are here. I reached out through the Youth Build person, and he's not able to be here. He's out of the state, right? And I have the two young men with me, so I just want to commend them. If I would give them a hand clap for just being here tonight. Thank you.
I won't keep you long. Thank you for hosting this. But just to address kind of what you asked earlier, how can there be, and what Gene Bradley said about better communication or how to get the message out, one thing that I would suggest is to maybe, instead of having the district attorney's office and the state police and the Brockton police and, you know, all of the, I like to call them alphabet men, you know, hosting a community forum, go to some of these community groups and have them be the host, and go have them do the promotion, have them go out and reach out to their people that attend their meetings, that are on their boards, or do, you know, do the work in the community that they do. It's intimidating for some people maybe to come into this atmosphere. And again, you know, if I were a ne'er-do-well and I came in and I saw that, I might be a little frightened, you know. So it's a psychological thing, and you know, some people might feel a little bit more comfortable also if instead of requesting that folks come out, go to where they are. So go to their community meetings, maybe suggest to the leaders that they have a community meeting here at the school, and in that way, the people will kind of go to their meeting, but then you can share your message. There's something else I was thinking too. Oh, food brings people. And maybe, like, I don't know what kind of budget you have, and everybody's kind of squeezing and pulling their belts really tight, but, you know, if you can offer maybe, like, a little gift card or some kind of takeaway, you know, that people can get, and it's very elementary, but it works, and it gets people out, and if you can just kind of get them to engage just that one piece, you might even get them to adopt the message. So that's just kind of my suggestion on that.
Thank you. Great points. I just want to point out, I did bring Nutri-Grain bars and some water in the back. How's that count? We don't have a big budget. Shayna Barnes.
Oh, one other thing, too. I'm city councilor at large. Hi. I'm not trying to set your schedule or how you do this, because I was at the other one too with the DA's office, and there were very few community people there. I was, you know, really actually saddened by that. I don't want to seem cynical, but it seems as of late, when there are preventative meetings instead of reaction meetings, if they're held closer to election time, you may also get more of attendance. I find that even here, you know, when it was around the election time, 2013, and even in 2015, this place was standing room only. So we're in an off year now. So I'm nobody's mother. I don't, you know, care about what they do. I came because I'm interested, and I want to be involved in this, make sure that I'm doing everything I can to address the issue and to partner with the various agencies in the city and do what we need to do. So, like I said, I'm not trying to schedule your meetings, but, you know, elections come up again in 2017, so I'm just saying.
Thank you.
I just want to, actually kind of note the past, like, three or four comments. There's a stream of continuity in there. There's something common to all of those, right? Communication. Coming out, getting, you know, how do we turn people out? What are our suggestions coming into the neighborhoods? And don't do it it's not a one-off or a one run, right? Do it over and over again. And to answer your question, the heart of what you're getting at is trust. And that is, if I can boil it down to one word, it's called trust. I don't gain that by talking to you right now just like this. Sorry, I don't. You don't know me any better right now, or maybe you know me a little bit better. It's about coming out. And I don't mean an election season. I mean every time. And being available. And answering the phone. And I'll tell you what, these gentlemen, the gang unit guys that are here, they'll tell you that. They have trust every day. I guarantee it. They do their jobs well. I haven't been here for very long. Been here for about 7 weeks. You can tell that trust is there. You know, and just in the few interactions that I have, those are those relationships that you guys are talking about. That interaction, talking to kids, cultivating those relationships. I guarantee you, those guys are steering kids in the right direction every day. That doesn't show up in a police report. So time, right? Time and repetition and access, right? That's what it boils down to. That boils down to trust. So. It's not a magic formula, tried and true, and like I said, these are the foundations for it right here. So.
There was another piece about the food. It's a draw. I don't care. You know that. I know it. We've all been to places, but the food is there, then it works, okay? You've got many, many businesses in this city that would be happy probably to give you a couple of pizza pies or whatever it may be for this type of meeting if that would help to keep the community out. That's another thing, Marie. That's something you can do from the office. you know, the old spaghetti dinner night work everywhere, and that's about the cheapest dinner you could possibly get, and I don't know too many people that don't like spaghetti, you know, so that's another piece. One other thing that I was thinking about as all of us have been talking, we come from the reference of what and where and who, how old we are, all kinds of things. What we don't do is think about these youngsters, where they are or where they aren't, what they don't have, the difference between what we grew up with and what they grew up with. Some things were mentioned that were automatic in almost all of our houses. You know, religion was there. You had to be in a certain time. You probably ate every night at the dinner. And if you weren't there, you answered to somebody. That doesn't go on today. These are things that these kids don't know, don't realize. So when you say certain things to them, the reference isn't there because they haven't had that love. They haven't had that nurturing that all of us, most of us, if not all of us, have had. So these are things, how do you get around that? How do you work with that? You know, you're not social workers, but you can't always be out as a problem. The gang unit's a good example. Those guys are out, they're semi-freelance. That helps them because they can move around and they can get into places and work with who they need to work with. But they're not always down their back. Sometimes they are trying to move these youngsters into a positive position. If you're getting a call because somebody's doing something, a lot of times you don't have the time to do that because you've got to stop that issue. But do you ever stop or go back and say, hey, I was here a couple of weeks ago, was there something that we said or something we could help you with? You mentioned the agencies out in the community. We have more agencies in this city, in Plymouth County, than anybody else does in the whole county. But there are a lot of people that don't know where they are, or what they do. That's another piece. Sometimes it's taking them to that place, okay? So it's all those kinds of things that builds up that trust, that ability for the individual to say, yeah, it was more than just throwing the bracelets on me. They took me to the next step. Or maybe I had to do that, but let me see you after court. Look, I know this place that maybe can do this or that for you. So there's two sides to you. That dichotomy is the kind of thing that makes a difference with some of these youngsters, because they've never received that from anybody. So, I mean, it's hard. I'm not trying to be your social worker. That's not the point. But you understand what I'm saying. But it has to happen for these kids to somehow join in to what's going on. The businesses. There was a time that when you got out of whatever the place was, your incarceration, it was a list of places to go. Find that today. Okay? It's not there like it used to be. So what can we do in the meantime? What kinds of programs can we do? We have a few programs in the city, what's for teens? Teen Challenge. They had a small group that they took on, besides themselves, to take some of the youngsters with them when they were around cleaning up the city. Wasn't getting a penny for it. Probably got some food, but wasn't getting a penny for it, okay? Those are the kinds of things, too, that we need to be able to do. Take some of these groups that we know are successful, have them work with some of these people that we know. And they've been very successful, whether it be drugs or whatever the situation may be. But we're not doing that. We're not doing that total circle, you know, that whole community. We're only doing one piece of it, and then we push it off and let it go to somebody else. And we can't do that. That's not what it was in the past, and that's a major difference of what was happening between then and now.
I've been sat here for about an hour now, and I've heard everybody criticize the DA's office for how they don't get the word out. We have two elected officials here who say that they're not doing a good job of, is what I read about getting the, wait a second, you had your time, I'll have my time, okay? I'd like to know, did Mike Brady's office, I'm sure they have a huge following, did they forward this out? Did Ms. Barnes, did you forward it out to your people? But they're not here. I look at this meeting differently. I've attended every one of these meetings. You know why nobody's here? Is because we have curbed a lot of the shootings that have happened in the city. We've done a lot of good work since January and December. And I had Miss, what's her name? She used to be in the DA's office. Jean Holmes here. What are you doing now? What are you doing now? Well, you know what? We've done it. That's why Jean Holmes is not here. If anybody looks at what the Brockton Police, the FBI, the DEA, the ATF, the District Attorney's Office, what we've done since back in 2015 when we told you we were addressing these issues, Take a look at our logs. Take a look at ShotSpotter. You can look at it. That's why nobody's here, because they don't have any. I haven't heard any complaints about crime yet. I've heard that we need food. I've heard that we need to raise every child that's in this city. I've heard all this stuff tonight, but nobody has talked about crime on their street. Why? Because the Brockton police, all these federal agencies, the state police, the CAT team that's in here, we are doing our job. We are out there curbing crime as best we can with the people that we have, and it's going very well. Knock on wood. Okay? But let's thank these people for having the meeting and the fact that nobody's here. Let's look at the other side of it. I think you're right, Austin. There's a breakdown of the family unit. You know what? Ken LaGrice has been in this city for over 30 years, okay, on this police department. We are not going to crawl off the family unit. You need to talk to your clergy. You need to address that with them. The police department, the FBI, and the DEA, the ATF, we're not going to cause it. We're the parents, okay? That's really what it comes down to. The family unit is broken down, and that's what needs to be addressed. And you know what? I don't consider that my job personally. My job is to enforce the laws in the city of Brockton, and those that break them, put them in jail.
No, it wasn't good enough.
Let me just clarify that point. My statement, it was based on the comment that I made, how do we improve our communication system? It has nothing to do with what the DA does. And I just want to mention that. The point was that how do we improve?
We always have the right to disagree. That's what's good about it.
It's how do we, I got to mention, because I'm here to represent my boss. I don't want to do anything stupid that will happen. The question was, how do we improve our communication system? I never said that DA was doing any of my job. It's like we're talking about, this is the meeting, it's an open mind meeting.
Let's talk about crime.
How do we improve that? So the point was that it's how do we improve our communication system? Okay. And give an explicit way of doing it. I'm not saying that my opinion was good, but it's not. It has nothing to do with DA. So I mean, I don't know about other people, but I was not criticizing anyone. I just wanted to make sure that you understand that. I live in this city. I know what you're going to do. You think I'm going to come here and say that the DA is going to do that? That's not what I said. It's how do we improve our communication system? And I said, by developing that relationship with everybody in the city, this will allow me to do that. This was the statement that I made. And I hope you understand that opinion based on my comment has nothing to do with whether or not the DA was doing anything. I just want to make sure that.
Okay, thank you.
Can I? I'm sorry.
People are okay, apathetic. They don't need to be here right now because crime is down. So what I'm saying is, I believe the word is getting out. They're not showing up for a reason, and that's because crime is down.
When you say live on television that people like that, you don't play with words. When you say that we are critiquing the DA, you know how the media will take it. You see what I mean?
Yep.
We gotta make sure that. I mean, I live in the city. That's my hometown. I live there. And I know how hard you guys are working for the service.
Thank you.
When you say something like everybody, that's a statement. Everybody is criticizing the DA. It's a bold statement. Our statement, me and the city council alive, was based on the debate that we are having in terms of like how do we improve our community. And I even go beyond that and say, well, the issue is not only in Brooklyn, it's all Massachusetts. So at least what that nation that we have this record that people can actually understand that it was my statement in terms of like how do we do it, but it has nothing to do with it. I just want to make sure that we get that. You see what I mean?
If I may, the last two meetings that this place was filled was within a couple of days of major crime incidents that happened, and people came out reaction to that. I won't say there's no crime in the city. There certainly still is, unfortunately. There has been a major improvement in it. But usually people respond, as most of us do, to the stimuli of what's going on in our life. So if there's nothing happened directly, maybe they're not out. Maybe they don't want to come out for the bad weather. I don't know. Maybe they're listening to people on TV tonight talk about what's what. But whatever the situation is, I'm unhappy not seeing more people out here because I've seen people in the past come out and talk. And it's what I was trying to address, and I think I'm saying that you folks also need to address, is how do we continuously do stuff? How do we take it a point beyond what you normally do? No, I don't want you to be a social worker, but I don't want you to be, you know, the guy with the whip either. So you, there has to be some commonality there. You know, I know you, and I know how you are, and that's not a problem. But it's number one is law enforcement, but there's other times when you're not having to pull out the bracelets. You can be the human you, and you do.
I think the police does a tremendous job.
And you do, right, I understand. But I think there's no indictment going on here across the board. The purpose of the meeting is, how does the community work with law enforcement and vice versa, and how do we get the word out? If we can figure out that one, as Maria asked me, you can be a trillionaire overnight across the world, because when it comes to parents, any organization, everybody's having trouble getting folks to participate. But this is one way for it to happen. And getting it out, there are a lot of people who will watch it on cable. Okay, so that's, even though they're not here, they'll see it at another time. This will show a number of times. So it's, I mean, those are things that we know, and that's the purpose, one of the purposes of doing it. We could just have you guys up there talking and still get the information out. But part of it is again, to let the community come to you so you know what's going on.
Just wanted to offer the perspective from the DA's office on this whole point. I think that there may be something to the idea that the drop in shootings, we seem to be in a quiet period through all the efforts of law enforcement in the city of Brockton. And I think that there's something to that, that a lower turnout is somewhat affected by that. But I also want to say that the district attorney Cruz, and I think the law enforcement agencies that are here tonight, we want to get more involvement, even in the good times, from community members. So, you know, from Steve, Ozzy, Shana, Gene, the ideas that you've shared here tonight, I think we have some good ideas about how to do further outreach, because I can tell you as the chief elected law enforcement officer in Plymouth County, DA Cruz and all of us want to see more people coming out, even if they're happy. Because one of the things that you said at the outset, Steve, was in your experience walking down villages and you knew the homes, you knew the people, and increasing the communication helped you do your job and keep the area safe. From our perspective, ideas that we've talked about here tonight, like trying to get out to the churches, to try to get out possibly even into the schools, whether it's having guest speakers or having maybe bringing the kids into the courthouses and get a chance to get a couple of speakers, maybe a judge and an assistant DA to hear how the system works. But anything that's going to, in a positive setting, increase contact, communication, can only improve the dialogue that's going on between the community and law enforcement. What I started out this meeting saying is absolutely true. Cooperation between the public and all of us here, whether it's out in the audience or at the front table here in law enforcement, that closer relationship can only improve what everyone wants, which is a safer city. Okay, so we appreciate the input and the ideas that everyone's offered here tonight. Okay, so let me open it back up to the floor.
You know, this meeting don't have so many people, So, but we're still here. We're still doing your job. The question I'm concerned about is because you hear that we need food for the people to come here. That's not true. That we don't need food here. The first time we wasn't have food here, but we have a lot of people come here. You know, we're not looking for food. The people in the city is not looking for food to be present here. They are looking for the truth. I mean, the people in the city, they may be a little bit intimidated by the police, you know, by the people with gun coming here. You know, they may be intimidated by that. But we, as a community in Brockton, we're not looking for food to be present at a meeting for the city. I just want you guys to understand that. You know, we need to look for a way to communicate with the people, the community, the association, the nonprofit. That's what we need to do, to get together and find a ground to get to the people in the city. We in the city, again, I repeat it for you, we're not looking for food to be present, to be involved in our community. And I'm really upset about that, to be fair.
Thank you. Because I was struggling here, we were going to get the food, you know, for a minute there. But I was going to ask you to make the pizza dinner and the spaghetti, you said.
Food is a draw.
One moment.
What did you say your name was again?
My name is Joseph.
Joseph, I agree with you 100%. Food's not going to bring people. We don't need props. We don't need food. I've been coming to these meetings for a lot of years. It's hard to drive turnout. And when you drive turnout, you have a big event. Sometimes it's a horrific event. It touches the community's heart. It touches their safety directly. People become alarmed. The media pushes it. And that's when we have 300-400 people. And then, of course, we had a mayor's race. And so they had particular interest people that wanted to be here. So apathy, like Detective LeGrice, Lieutenant LeGrice mentioned, it's hard to sustain turnout. But right now, the community's been safe. We've been doing some great things out here. The FBI is a great partner with Brockton Police and the State Police, and they deserve a hand because of the assets and the resources and the support that they've been providing. And the impact players that have been taken off the street and the prosecutions by the DA's office. Look, there's a lot of good things going on in your community. A lot of good things. And are we going to have upticks in crime? Absolutely. We've had peaks and valleys in crime for the 30-plus years I've been involved. But turnout, to drive turnout, is extremely hard. And so what can I say? I'm going to say this. Communication, trust, all those things. Boy, we've been talking about that forever. We have some communication. I agree. Food's not going to drive turnout. You and I, we got communication. It's not going to drive. But all of you people being here, being supportive, you know, we don't miss that. You know, that touches us. We need your support. We need your community support. We need your safe neighborhoods. We need you to pick up the phone and call Brockton PD. Our community action team and the Brockton Police Patrol Division, we just don't lock up everyone. We resolve a lot of things on the street with conversation. You know, we do. We have a lot of discretion. Yes, we got to lock up a lot of people because we can't communicate with them. So, look, if we could communicate, this world would be a greater place today, not just Brockton, a greater place. So, you know, again, I want to thank you all for coming out, and I just wanted to say all these key points. We've heard them. We understand them. You people understand them. And we're on the same team with you all, okay? Our goal, our objective is a safe city of Brockton. Your neighborhood being safe, your school zones being safe. Those are the big things.
Thank you, Tony. And to keep everyone coming back to these meetings, we set a goal of trying to keep close to that 1 hour time period. And I see we got a little bit of a late start, but we're about 115 minutes into it now. I don't want to shut anyone off if they have a question that's been burning deep inside tonight. Is there anyone else that wants to raise a question?
Actually, not a question. I just want to say thank you because the police officer again, I want to let you know on behalf of the entire community, we appreciate the job that you're doing in Brockton. I've been living in Brockton for more than 22 years, and I can say Now, the police department has done a marvelous job, and I'm pleased with it. Because one thing I believe that I learned when I was at the academy, like you guys, every single stop that a police officer makes, it could be the last stop of his life. So we appreciate the job you're doing. And guys, please, again, they deserve it. Let's give them a round of applause. Let you know that we love you. Okay? Thank you.
Hi, this is, not sure who is pertaining to, probably Brockton PD, the young man at the table wanted me to ask. Any news that's going on Oak Street on usually Sunday evenings? Is it pertaining to traffic? Oak Street. Anyone familiar what's going on Oak Street on Sunday evenings? I mean, at the house by sleep by then.
It's just dealing with between 11 o'clock and 1 o'clock in the morning. There's probably 40 or 50 cars that zoom up and down Oak Street through Avon, and then it's a continuous thing for the last couple of years. I was just wondering. I had to be the only person to complain about something tonight.
Drag racing?
We appreciate those are the races that we are addressing. We've moved them all around the city. We've done them up at the mall. They've done Reynolds Memorial Highway. They moved over Oak Street. They were doing Route 28. The north end of it for a while. But yes, they are out there doing the addressing that on Sunday nights. So,
I know it's right in between the shift change and there's a lot of things going on.
Well, you know, honestly, these gang guys will look into it too, because they work 7 p.m. to 3 a.m., so they don't go in for shift change, but we will definitely take care of that. Okay?
LT, I'd just like to thank you for having that conversation. We have some young people here tonight, and we just have to let them know conversations are difficult, but you still have to have them, even if you don't agree on them.
Absolutely.
Thank you so much for being candid and frank. And one thing I'll always like to say is these young men right here are assets to the community, not a liability. We are all in this together. One thing about Brockton, I've been here 25 years, and I found out Brockton is a proud community. Yes. I'm a Dorchester kid originally. When I came here, the Harrington and the UNIS administration, they convinced me that this is the place to raise children. My kids are not feared of law enforcement. The conversations are difficult, even if you don't agree with them. And in our house, I can't have anyone come and say, put this chair here, do this, that. I wish Black Lives Matter to Black people. I wish Cape Verdean Lives Matter to Cape Verdean, and so on and so forth. We are the ones that have to make the change tonight. We are the ones that have to push and collaborate. One thing I was saying, Chief, is when I went down those patrols, gentlemen of the same dude, that community was with me. I had no credibility until they seen me through the course of the year. And sometimes I had to put my life in their hands and vice versa. But these are the conversations we must have. We don't have to agree, no. But you have to be frank, you have to be honest, and you don't have to bow to nothing. The truth will always find its time. Truth can't be hidden with us for so long. We could be as Chicago, 4 to 5 shootings daily. And he got shooters, we got shooters. And that's how they do in Chicago. If you've been through the Midwest, it's horrific. You have to mount up, like everyone else. You don't have to do that here. These young men go to Massasoit, I go to Canton campus, and they're striving to do great things. But don't ever stop the conversation. You're not gonna be right. You're not gonna be wrong. But don't cut it off. LTX, one time.
Thank you.
Ken, could you talk about the new drug program real quick? I know you've mentioned it earlier that violence has gone down, but it seems like overdoses have gone up. Just talk about the PPD's new drug program.
Well, I think that
I think a lot of the communities are struggling with the opiate overdose problem, not just the city of Brockton. You see it in every community in Plymouth County and in the state, across the country. I think, again, the Brockton Police, the Brockton Fire Department, through their efforts and the use of Narcan, we saved a lot of lives with that. And hopefully that, you know, there's a new law that went into effect on the 22nd of February. It makes distribution of sale of fentanyl, trafficking in fentanyl, a 20-year sentence, up to 20 years in jail. So I know the legislature's taking it seriously, and hopefully the courts will. I think that will help our issue if we start addressing some of those.
Can you talk about the champion plan just real quick? Just explain how it works, what it is.
Yeah, you'll have to go to somebody else for that.
Can address that. Right here. Hi, I'm Corin Capiello. I'm the Director of Social Services from the Mayor's Office. I'm just gonna help him out with the Champion Plan. So the Champion Plan was created and we launched on February 29th, where individuals with substance use disorders can walk into Brockton Police Department and say that they need help into treatment. From there, they will be Corey checked. So if you have a warrant, it's probably not a good idea to come. I am telling people that. From there, they will be taken to Stairway Recovery, which is a peer-led support center funded by BSAS, where we will be working with people to help them to get into treatment. So we'll be seeing what their level of care is. Most individuals so far, we placed 12 individuals. Most individuals were getting into detox. But that's basically a summary of the program. We're partnering with Brewster Ambulance. Brewster is transporting them, so they don't need transportation. And what makes our program a little different from others is that we're really working with them while they're actually in the treatment facility on their follow-up plans. So we're really hoping that they're not just in detox and out. We're working with them to make sure that they're getting further treatment after if they want it. So. There's a veteran component. If people have served in the military, they will go to the VA only if they want to. Okay. You're welcome.
Any other questions? Any other points? Yes, sir.
I'm a Sergeant of Operation Archangels. I just want to personally thank all of you for being here, the Brockton PD, the Brockton Gang Unit, the DA's office, FBI, everybody, the stateies. If it wasn't for any of you, there'd be a lot more deaths in Brockton than there is today. Thank you very much.
Anybody else? Any other questions? Points? Sir?
Hi, my name is Justin. All right. One of the biggest things that we had last year was King of the Court. This is where the kids blame the course of the cops. That was a very big turnout. Okay, I think if we have more
There's an old saying, kids in sports stay out of courts. So the recreation is an important part of keeping the young people's schedules filled so that they're not out getting into trouble. So we agree with you 100%. Thank you.
Take some time, maybe one more comment or last comment, because again, thank
you. Sure, let's go for one more and then we're gonna call it a night at an hour and a half.
It won't be long. My name is Robert Miller. First of all, I just want to tell you, I moved here 41 years ago, and like Ozzy said, the streets were a lot different back then, drastically changed. But I want to commend you all for what you do. I see you guys out there all the time, and I appreciate it. Just from my own knowledge, I was wondering how the crime rates stand since 2014, and that was my question. And my suggestion is, I know Brockton has coffee with a cop, and stuff like that. Why don't you guys challenge the kids to a football game or a flag football game or something like that to get them out there? I'm sure they'd be happy to play you.
Good point. Get ready.
Kenny, you want to take up the challenge?
Got some players?
Yeah, if there's an over 50 league, we might be interested.
Coming, we're going to have a soccer championship as a Haitian community partner is going to form a soccer championship for the kids to be participating. You know, they will have rewarded and everything, big money, big.
And they'll play with cops.
Yeah.
And everybody. Oh, great!
To be participating, they are welcome. You know.
Soccer, get ready. Do you know how to do that? I'm Kay Bray. I'm about to break up the soccer thing. Hold on.
One of the things is the Brockton After Dark program that starts at the end of the school year, where a lot of the police officers have been involved with that over the years, playing basketball at the different operations that are going on in the city every night from roughly, I think it's 5 o'clock till about, I think it's 10 is the latest that they're doing it. There's all kinds of programs. There are police officers quite often all over the city participating as part of that on their own time, by the way. So this has been working. It's problematic in that we never have enough money to do the kinds of things we need to do because it costs to be in those places, to the different gyms, the different some of the parks, etc., any equipment to be out there for these youngsters. So that's another part of it that's a problem. But those are the things that in the past we had the policemen's or patrolmen's association was working with kids and challenging, as it was said, to some playing whatever, not just soccer, but baseball, everything that you can think of, including with the young ladies. So it's, like I said, there's nothing new. It's just to continue those things that have been going on and to bring those younger kids that haven't been involved in the past into this stuff. Thank you.
Thank you.
It's been a great meeting tonight. I'd like to thank everyone for coming out, and we will see you in early May. Thanks, everyone. Good night.